नमस्ते, माय नेम इज प्रणव अनुजा एंड आई बिलोंग टू फैकल्टी ऑफ लॉ एंड गवर्नेंस एंड इन टुडे सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट सेंट थॉमस एक्विनास। सो सेंट थॉमस एक्विनास ऑक्यूपाइज एन इम्पॉर्टेंट प्लेस इन द हिस्ट्री ऑफ द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ नेचुरल लॉ डॉक्ट्रिन। ही हैड स्टडीज एज अ डोमिनिकन मॉन्क अंडर सर अल्बर्ट मैग्नस एंड इन लेटर ईयर्स प्रोड्यूस्ड वर्क्स ऑफ लास्टिंग सिग्निफिकेंस इन विच ही अफेक्टेड सिंथेसिस ऑफ द लॉजिक ऑफ एरिस्टोटल। The religious thoughts of the early Christian fathers and some of the patterns of classical modern law. In his celebrated Summa Theologica, he set out a fully systematized approach to law, which even today dominates the thinking of many Catholic jurists. And as evidenced by the growing neo-scholastic school of jurisprudence, law is to be understood as part of God's plan for mankind. This is the belief which is central to the concepts which I will mention soon. It is important to remember the context within which Aquinas worked. The authority of the Catholic Church was expanding, and those whose task it was to explain doctrine were guided by a strict pattern of thought. Interpretation of scriptures had produced two principles which were of direct relation to attempts at explaining the nature of law. First, it was the principle of unity based on one God and one church was reflected in the wish for one church believing in one law. Secondly, it was the principle of supremacy of law, which was seen as an aspect of the unity of the world, taught that all persons, including rulers, were under the law's dominion. Aquinas' general approach to law was fashioned with these principles in mind. At this time, the study of the works of Aristotle was not always welcomed by the dominant church hierarchy, which viewed his scientific rationalism as a potential threat to the church dogma. Master did not share this attitude. He was deeply impressed by Aristotle's emphasis on reason and the primacy of intelligence. He made a deep study in Aristotle's work, lectured philosophers publicly on their significance, and was affected profoundly by their elucidation of the part which could be played by reason in the understanding of phenomena such as law. In the Summa Theologica, Aquinas seeks to establish the framework of a systematized science of theology. He employed various techniques wherein there was formal wild style of arguments which was common in his day. Questions were posed, sub-questions emerged and are answered, further argument lead to attempted refutation until an outline of proof and a final enunciation of an answer to the original question appear. The exposition of law associated with Aquinas is derived in Summa Theologica, wherein he gives wherein from question 90 to 97, he has talked in detail about the exposition of law. And law is perceived always as a God's instrument for assisting men in the lifelong process leading to the perfection of his nature. Aquinas begins his examination and interpretation of law by considering morality. The very basis of moral obligation is to be discovered within his man nature. Built into his nature is a group of God-given inclinations. They include self-preservation, propagation of the species, and inclination towards a search of truth. Man is guided by a simple and basic moral truth: to do good and to avoid evil. Because man is rational, he is under a natural obligation to protect himself and to live peacefully within society. A peaceful, ordered society demands human laws fashioned for the direction of social behavior. These human laws will arise from man's rational capacity to discern correct patterns of good conduct. The rules underlying human laws will derive from a moral system which ought to be taken into account by all mankind. And this ought to be proposition is the thesis of natural law. Law must be thought of, according to Aquinas, as linked essentially with reason. A law may be considered as a rule and also as a measure of the nature of human activities. He reminds us that the word lex is derived from ligare, which means to bind, and that law binds us to act in particular ways. The rules and measures of human acts are to be thought of in terms of law, and also in terms of justice, so to speak. And there is this thing called end. Reason directs us to the fulfillment of our ends, and this end is nothing but an Aristotelian concept. Man's laws should go hand in hand with reason. Indeed, man's laws may be thought of as ordinances of reason for common good, made by those who have care for community and are promulgated. The natural law is promulgated by the very fact that God has instilled it into man's mind so that it can be known naturally. So the natural law is a product of God's human nature and natural law. Theology and philosophy together will help in the quest for comprehension of the truth. Aquinas is suggesting that a synthetic approach to a study of law, in which Christian dogma and Aristotelian philosophy will produce a clear understanding of the nature and power of God's law. So he created a fourfold division of law, the first of which is lex aeterna, that is eternal law. All laws, insofar as they participate in high reason, are derived from eternal law. This is the divine intellect and will of God directing all things. God's rational guidance is not subject to constraint of time. It is eternal. Not to know eternal law, God's plan for his creatures is to be without direction, so that one's true ends can never be achieved. But awareness of the eternal law is imprinted on us. God alone knows the eternal law in its totality, but those few blessed persons who have been able to know God in his essence may perceive its truth. Thus, on a second is lex divina, that is divine law, is the eternal law governing man and may be known by him through direct revelation, as in the scriptures, for example, the Ten Commandments. Man requires a type of law that can direct to him to his end, namely eternal happiness. Such law contains no error and forbids all sins, allowing no evil is to go unpunished. Aristotle had argued that man had a natural purpose and an end, so that natural law known through human reason could provide an adequate guide. Aquinas distances himself from Aristotle at this point, because man's eternal happiness is related to God's plan. Man needs direction from God's law, in addition to human law and natural law. Natural law comes from man's rational knowledge of the God, but that knowledge is by its nature limited. Divine law comes through revelation, directly from God. Revelation is the guide for man's reason, allowing his highest nature to be perfected by divine's grace. Here, an interesting example of Aquinas giving a Christian gloss to the views of pagan Greeks and achieving an imaginative synthesis. So the third type of natural law is lex naturalis. In lex naturalis, it is the natural law, so which is man's participation in eternal cosmic law, as it is known through reason. Because of man's possession of God-given reason, he may enjoy a share in divine reason itself and may derive from it a natural inclination to such actions and ends as are fitting, such as the search for good and the avoidance of evil. Where man exercises his reason correctly, he will understand the fundamental principles of God's plan. Basic principles for human guidance will emerge, such as the good is to be done and evil is to be shunned. But because of bad customs and habits, some humans will ignore the natural law, and the result is a division of their energies from those tasks of a life fulfilling kind. Now the fourth type of law is human law, that is called lex humana, involving the particular application of the natural law and resulting in legislation by governments. just as men draw conclusions in the various sciences from natural alone, but in demonstrable principles, so declare Aquinas, human beings must draw from the precepts of natural law answers to problems which emerge when they live together in society. Where human law conforms to the laws of reason, it conforms to the laws of gods and advances human development. So you see a significant aspect of Aquinas' concept of human law, which has overtones of relevance for the present day, is the relationship he perceives between human law and moral dimensions. He repudiates the thesis that a law is a law merely because it has been decreed by a sovereign. He suggests that a rule takes on the character of law only where it has appropriate moral dimensions. Certain questions must be asked. Does the rule exist in the conformity to the precepts of natural law? And does it suggest agreement with the basis of moral law? That which is not just seen is no law at all, he declares. Where a human law diverges from law of nature, it is no longer a law, but a mere perversion of the law. Such a law cannot bind in conscience. This is not to say, however, this is must not therefore be obeyed. Obedience to it might be essential so as to prevent an even greater evil, such as the spread of lawlessness, scandal, or greater harm. Aquinas takes a further step forward. Laws which are opposed to the divine plan, such as the laws of tyrants, inducing to idolatry, must not be observed. Our duty is to obey God rather than man. A law which is in violation of natural law should not, in general, be obeyed. There are many jurists inside and outside the Catholic Church who see Aquinas as a divinely inspired genius, able to synthesize a variety of approaches and capable of bringing system into an unwieldy group of theories. In moving beyond his predecessors and contemporaries, he was able to produce a unified set of principles in relation to the law. Natural law is envisaged as a source of general principles rather than detailed jurisprudential rules. Above all, perhaps, is the elevation of human reason in the service of comprehension of law. God's law is the reason of divine wisdom. Christianity is reason. Human institutions, including those related to law, required the exercise of reason if they are to be built in enduring fashion. The Thomist view of law is fundamentally that of Cicero. That when Cicero claimed, as we saw in the last session, that true law is the right reason in agreement with nature, and God is the author of this law, its promulgator and its enforcing judge. In essence, the proper effect of the law is to make man good. It should lead men to their proper virtue. Now, what could be the ingest if you have to answer this, that what is Aquinas' theory of law? Then there is this introduction that Thomas Aquinas was concerned with systematized knowledge on the basis of Catholic doctrine so that the cosmos might be understood as a vast unit in which everything had a place and had a meaning. And within this knowledge of within the system of knowledge, God's plan for mankind occupied a special place, and law was to be comprehended as a part of those plans. And Aquinas propounded a theory of law based on his concept of reason. And this resulted in a fourfold division of law, in which so-called natural law is of much significance. So, a near about good answer of Aquinas' theory of law would be introduction and background of Aquinas, influence of Aristotelian thought, fourfold division of law, problems of morality, violation of natural law and its consequences, conclusion, stressing the work of Aquinas as a synthesizer of philosophy and religious thought in its interpretation of law. Moving on, we will discuss more on Stammler's point of law and Finnis' point of law in natural law. Till then, thank you.